Hello, my name is Xavier Grobet. I am one of the cinematographers on The Watchmen, and you're listening to Go Creative Show.
Hey, everyone. My name is Ben Consoli. I am the director and owner of BC Media Productions, and this is the Go Creative Show, a podcast for filmmakers. So today we have Xavier Grobet. He's a cinematographer and director of photography for The Watchmen on HBO, which is just an unbelievable show. And I know you guys are going to absolutely love this episode. I am such a big fan of the show. It looks so good. And Xavier tells us exactly how he gets it done. And of course, we have some audience questions in there as well. And that's just coming up in a couple of minutes. But a couple things I want to bring to your attention. First of all, we have some offers from friends of the show, OpenReel. OpenReel has single-handedly kept my company alive because it allows you to do virtual remote filmmaking through iOS. And you can get 10% off by simply using my name or the name of the podcast. So there's at openreel.com. And then Soundstripe is giving us 15% off for a subscription on their website. And they've got really good music on that site. So if you're in need of music, and I know anybody listening to this show probably is in need of music for their projects, 15% off simply by going to gocreativeshow.com/soundstripe and then using Go Creative Show in the promo code. So some offers for our Go Creative Show family here out there. All right, let's dive right in because we have a lot to talk about. With the director of photography for The Watchmen on HBO, Xavier Grobet, ASC. So I'm here with Xavier Grobet, ASC, the director of photography for HBO's The Watchmen. Thank you so much for being on.
Hello, everyone. Hi, Ben.
So now, I know that you are one of a few directors of photography on the show.
Yeah.
Which episodes did you work on?
I worked on episodes 3, 5, and 7.
Okay. So you came in a couple episodes in.
Yeah.
And the look was kind of established before you jumped onto the project. Am I right?
Yes, by the time I got to Atlanta and started working, Greg Middleton, who is the main DP for the series, had already created the look with Nikki Cassell, the director slash producer. So by the time I got in, there was like a whole Bible and a whole look of the show that that had already been established. Yeah.
Do you like working that way? Do you like coming on and kind of having a direction ahead of time?
You know, it's always great to come in and create your own vision. But in this case, I mean, the imagery and the material is so strong visually that in a way I kind of like had the same kind of like feel and approach to what Greg and Nikki had already created. So I just pretty much embraced it. And it was pretty much what I was thinking anyway. So
yeah,
it was interesting that way.
Now, Greg, you said did episode 2.
2.
But not the pilot. So usually, at least the way I understand it and the way people have talked about it on the show before, is the pilot sets the tone for the look of the series. But you're telling me that Gregory in episode 2 set the look. So what was it about the pilot? Like, what was the pilot just produced and shot independently before it was a full series?
Yeah, so this show was very complicated in the way it was organized. The pilot was shot way in advance. The pilot was shot by André Parej. I think that's how you pronounce his name. They shot it back a few months before. Then when the show started, getting ready to gear up for the whole series, at the same time, they started shooting the whole part of Jeremy Irons that happens in the moon Europa. Most of it was shot in Wales. And that was shot during the summer before we got in to do main photography for the series. Wow. And so that was shot in advance with the main directors, but with an English cinematographer. I can't remember their names right now. So they shot those sequences there. And then when we started pre-production in Atlanta, that's when Greg came in and he kind of went back to the beginning and started creating the look completely. So a lot of the things that have that had been shot on the pilot kind of like weren't completely with the style and with the, that, you know, they realized there were things that they could be improved. And so they pretty much worked on the pilot quite a bit. Not because it was something wrong about it. It was just things that could be improved to get into the style of the show, you know?
How do you describe the style of The Watchmen?
Based a lot on what a graphic novel is and what this graphic novel is. So we try to emulate like framings from the comic book, types of the way that in the comic book and in the graphics, you play with volume and distance and perspective. We were always trying to shoot through things, like making the frames interestingly busy and complex. So we were always looking for that angle, you know. So it's a style that is, you know, a lot very much based on a graphic novel. We had a lot of like toys, let's say, to create an image, to play with the image, like different sets of lenses. We had a Ronin available to do camera moves. We were able to, you know, always be looking for interesting angles, either really low or super high, you know, creating all this like comic book language in a way. You know?
Now, at this point, I mean, we've had decades now of comic book movie or comic books being adapted into TV shows and films. Uh-huh. So how do you maintain like that look of a comic book so that it feels right for the people watching? It feels like what it is, but then also have something fresh and different. That I can only imagine is a bit of a challenge to kind of toe the line between the two.
Well, the show has this very specific world that we portrayed because it's an alternate reality. It's like the comic book happens in the 80s and Watchmen, the TV show, happens in 2019. So it's not the same time. It's nowadays, but in a reality where Robert Redford is a president. And the show is the way it's structured and the way it was geniusly adapted by Damon was to talk about all these racial issues that we're living now, which, I mean, the show is so relevant nowadays with everything that's happening. This is like a year before. So it's just weird to know that the things that we were talking about a year before are like so prominent right now. So even though it's a comic book, it's not really, it's based on that comic book, but it's also like a reality. It's a real show, like with all this fantasy happening, but it's pretty grounded, I think. So it was not just like, it's not superheroes, it's vigilantes and it's human beings in a way, no? The only, you know, superhuman figure is Dr. Manhattan. But even him in the show is kind of like human scales, you know?
As based in reality as a comic book movie can be, mm-hmm. I feel like this is. Like it, the look of it is, it's an alternate universe, yes, but it feels familiar. Like you're watching it and it definitely feels like a lot of it is of our time right now.
Right. This is what makes the show so interesting because it is an altered reality, but it's real, but it's like nowadays and it could be what is happening right now. Yeah. Which is actually what's happening right now.
It's amazing because, you know, it's just crazy that the state of our country now, and then you watch The Watchmen and there's so many parallels and it's pretty wild. I mean, it must be so interesting to you and the entire team that worked on it to just see what's going on now and think like, wow, this is what we were kind of shooting 2 years ago or whatever it may be.
Yeah. For example, like the cops wearing masks.
Yeah.
Which is what we're doing right now. It's just the image is just exactly the same as what we're living now. You know, so Tulsa, Oklahoma, 1921, where the show starts, is where Trump wants to do his first rally.
Yeah.
Everything is just so like intertwined. It's kind of scary in a way, you know?
Yeah, it is very, very weird. Yeah. So The Watchmen takes place in an alternate reality, like we mentioned, but also it's rooted in actual reality. There's a lot of it that looks very real, very now, and very modern. So from a cinematography standpoint, how are you towing that line between the two? What are some of the techniques that you're using to give it that real look, but also maintain that alternate reality that we're living in?
Well, it's many things. I mean, it's not just the cinematographer's responsibility. It's like a team group. What? How do you accomplish something like this? In the sense of, when I read a script, I always like try to go deep into it and see what it is about. When I read it, I'm not only imagining, or kind of like creating images in my head of what it should look like, but also like, what is the story that we're telling? So I always like to, read it and sit down with the director and go, through the script scene by scene and talking about every scene and what is important in that scene, what is the information that we need to deliver and how we're going to do it, how we're going to paste all the pieces together to create a sentence, words to create a sentence. So that's important that in the beginning, to create a visual understanding, especially episode 3, for example. I really liked it because it had very little dialogue scenes. So it was very visual. So every scene was planned more for their visuals than, I think there's only like 2 or 3 scenes where 2 people are talking to each other, which is when you end up like doing, close-ups or stuff. But but even in those situations, we were always trying to find the right angle and the interesting way to tell the story. But so basically that episode is very, very visual. So it was a joy to explore each scene and tell the story visually,
Can you give an example of a scene where you maybe you approached it in a different way or a unique way or found that interesting angle that, gave it a little something extra?
I don't know, the way that when Laurie Blake, when they arrived to the motel in the beginning, the way we planned the shots of the car arriving, they getting out, walking through the alleys, getting into the rooms, like every shot was planned and it had a graphic novel aspect to it, it was an overhead shot or there were some other shots that they didn't use, which I was, in love with, that we created these kind of like long hallways and stuff like that were really exciting. But so creating like just the exact images that we needed to tell that story, or when she's getting ready to go to the funeral, the way we did all these like insert shots, to tell the story that she's strapping a gun on her leg and getting one other, anyway, creating this this whole atmosphere. Or the beginning scene when she goes to the bank and to get that first vigilante that's dressed like a Batman character, the way she walks into the bank where we don't see her face. This is the introduction of this character, so we don't see her face at all throughout the whole first part of the scene. But we establish the characters that are in the bank that you don't know what their role is going to be, but you can like see them, the guy that is reading the newspaper, the other guy that is attending. So you establish all the pieces without knowing that in a second, everything's going to burst and then everybody has something to do and something to, to say there in that scene. So kind of like building those moments and seeing who do we need to see and how, to create this tension. And, so it's all... That's the beauty part of it. That it's not just that somebody tells you what's going to happen. It's like you have to tell the audience that something is about to happen, and you have to create that tension with images and with editing and with So that's the fun part of like creating the visual part of it.
I can tell you just love this stuff. As you're explaining it, you're like your eyes are lighting up. I can see you get all excited.
Yeah.
It's great. It's really fun to watch you remember these moments and have a good time with it. I love that.
Yeah, it's like that's to me that's not just shooting them and being in the set, which is the most fun part of our business, except for who knows what's gonna be like after what we're living in nowadays. But just creating all this language, and I like doing drawings, so I do drawings kind of like really badly drawn, but it's a good exercise for me, and also to share my vision with the director. And so we create storyboards of the scenes, and so it's fun to see that when you create and you put in a little piece of paper, then you see it put together in reality, and it's fun, you know.
Oh, so you're doing your own, you're making your own hand-drawn storyboards sometimes.
Yeah, most of the times. I mean, if we need like a professional storyboard artist, we'll get in for specific scenes where, you know, there's a big stunt that we need to understand so that we get somebody who's good at it. But sure. Me, myself, I just like to, whatever we talk about the scene, I just do drawings on my script. And I kind of like present them to the director, and, you know, it might clear some ideas of what I'm trying to talk about. And it's just fun for me to do it, you know, for me to understand
that.
It. Yeah.
I want to dive a little bit deeper into your prep process. Mm-hmm. Can you walk me through how it begins for you? Starting from, I'm assuming it begins with the script gets sent to you.
Well, for example, in the case of this show, because it was such a complex show and the graphic novel is such a complex book, and I was not completely familiar with it, I have to say. I mean, I knew the story, I had seen the movie, I had never read the graphic novel, but so it was like it took me like a while when I first got to Atlanta where we shot, kind of like just get familiar with everything, like reading the graphic novel, reading the scripts, the ones that were available, looking at the Bible book that Nikki and Greg had created, all the images, all the images that were the inspiration, all the drawings, all the sets, you know. So by the time I got there, a bunch of it was already in process, no? In the yeah. process. So that took me quite a while to, like, you know, who is this character? Because some of our characters are real characters from the comic book, but only, you know, 30 years, 40 years later?
Yeah, yeah.
So kind of like understanding who they are, where they're coming from, and what every, if you know, for people who know the comic book and have seen the series, there's so many little things that are immediate reflections of the comic book in our reality that some people who don't know the comic book might not catch on the moment, you know. So yeah. it's full with bits of information, and so that made it really fun to like try to incorporate some of those elements from the book into our picture. Sometimes it could be something that it wasn't just a literal translation from the comic book to the series, but maybe there was an image that you saw in one of the chapters in the book, and it's like, oh, look at this image. This would be great for this moment. And so we embrace that energy, you know, in graphically.
So you get your script, you start yeah. thinking about visuals. Is the next step after that location scouting, or do you start working with the production designer? Like what if you could kind of give us the fundamental steps that you take from script to shooting?
Yeah, on the one hand, you have the script. The production designer has already read it as well, and maybe has already started sketching ideas of sets or looking at locations that he might come, you know, to suggest to the director and to myself. So,
yeah,
the production designer is starting to do his thing. I'm reading the script and I'm trying to breaking it down from my perspective in terms of, you know, if there's anything specific that I need to address technically, whether it's a piece of equipment or a way of shooting certain part, any description, there might be something that is very specific move of camera, and I need to figure out what piece of equipment I need to have for that. And then yeah. on the same moment where, you know, I'm starting to work with the director, and we sit down and we go reading the script and try to get our ideas up on the table. Maybe he has things that, you know, he or she has in mind that wants to do, or maybe I bring my ideas as well. We talk about them. And then the process is combining what the production designer with locations have in mind. And so we come out the first time and we go and see locations. And so we see the locations and we start, once you start getting concrete places, like real places and that fit your image, like, oh, I imagine it this way. Oh, this is perfect. So
yeah.
you can like start blending your ideas, everybody's ideas with the reality, which is the location that you get. For example, the bank in the beginning of that episode.
Sure.
So then once you start seeing locations and choosing them, then it's clearer, because then you start, you know, imagining everything in that space, and then it's easier to continue creating more and more language based on that location.
Yeah.
So that's the second part of it, or, you know, the main part of it. And it might take, you know, many location scouts to find all the real locations, you know, all the right locations, you know.
Yeah. So the location really determines quite a bit. You can have something in your mind, but if the location doesn't allow it, it's not going to happen.
Right. Or if the location doesn't exist, then we need to build it.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's also like a budget issue. Like even in Watchmen, even in any project, there's always budget issues. So maybe we can't build it, or maybe it's better to build it and not, you know, do the location. I mean, it's all like a puzzle where between production and ourselves and everybody put together to see what is the best way to approach it. No?
We have a question from Motion in Reverse on Instagram asking, was the series mostly shot on soundstage or location?
Yeah, it was definitely a blend of both. And I would say a lot of it was locations, a lot of it. We use locations from downtown Atlanta to towns outside of Atlanta as well. You know, it was a heavy location project for sure. Yeah.
Yeah. Talk to me about the camera package that you used for The Watchmen.
So we had the Alexa Mini, and we had the Cook S5s, I think, as our main lenses. But then we also had the a set of anamorphic lenses, and we had the tilt and swing lenses.
Tilt and swing, what does that mean?
The tilt and swing lenses are, it's like these lenses on a bellows where you can change the plane, the focal plane of the lens, so you can defocus the
side. Is it the same as tilt shift?
The same thing.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
What did I call them?
You call it tilt and swing, which I never heard of. Maybe that's one of the ways people refer to.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Oh, okay. So a tilt shift lens. Yeah, I'm looking at it now. So you had some of those for the show.
Yes. Yes. So, you know, so that will sometimes will help us like create a focus on two different planes at the same time, or, you know, stuff like that. Because we were always looking to play with foreground and background, you know, elements.
Yeah.
So that was part of the style. So those three lenses were like the main thing. We would use like the anamorphics for a certain angle or to create a certain emotion.
Yeah.
Or a close-up or something, just to create something visually different, you know.
You were mixing a few different formats in there.
Yes. Not formats, just lenses. Well,
few different lenses to get a few different looks, I should say.
Looks, yes. Yes. Uh-huh.
Well, the show kind of it bounces back. The whole show begins with like a silent film look. And then there are episodes completely in black and white. And then there's episodes. So there's a lot of different looks and styles incorporated into the series.
Yeah. And that was the challenging thing about the show, because every episode was like getting a script for a new movie, for a completely different project, you know? Like, for example, episode 7 is in Vietnam. It's like, how are we going to make Vietnam in Georgia? You know?
So, well, how did you? Well, let's talk about it. So episode 7 takes place in Vietnam.
Yes.
I mean, The Watchmen has a lot of individual episodes with a lot of individual looks.
Yes.
How did you approach creating that look for that episode?
Well, the same. It's like choosing the location, like, you know, locations, VFX, and production design together, you know. And I created a specific look for the Vietnam section where it was a lot more colorful and rich, and just to make it look different. Because it's also, you're talking about Angela Barr's past, so it could be treated as something different. The same way that her dream is in black and white, her memories. So this one was that other different reality. And so the rest was like, we got a street, first of all, a street in, I can't remember the town in Georgia. It was a bit far from, Atlanta. I feel like an hour away or something. I'll remember the name too. I'm sorry. My memory is terrible. So we chose a street that we could close for a certain amount of time for dressing, for to be able to like operate everything. You know, it's a complex scene that we have an explosion and we have kids and we have tons of people. And so between extras, production design, color, lenses, I actually chose different lenses for that section. Like I got some vintage lenses from Panavision.
Nice.
So kind of like creating a different reality with the elements that you had. I was scared. I mean, like, how are we going to make this look like Vietnam? But it's like, you know, once you're in it and you put all the pieces together, you go with the flow, you know?
Did you have a DIT on set with you the whole time?
Yes, the whole time. Yes.
Yeah. It seems like you really have to, because you can't just set a look, you know, throw on a LUT and be done with it. You're making a lot of changes.
We had a lot that Greg created. I did a little tweaking for myself because of just the way he works with contrast and the way I work with it too. So I adjusted it a little bit to sort of feel more comfortable with it. You know, every DP has a different way of doing things. But basically always maintaining the same saturation and contrast and everything. So that our DIT was mainly, you know, taking care of making it all blend together, you know?
Yeah. So everything that you shot, or the whole show, was on the Alexa Mini, but each cinematographer had some lens selections that they made.
Not necessarily. I think the lens selection was always the same.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was only for that Vietnam episode that I chose to do that.
Okay.
But all the others were, you know, with the same lenses. Yeah, same equipment. Yeah.
Did you put any filters on your lenses?
Sometimes. I don't remember what we were doing. Maybe I can remember we had some soft effects maybe, or black magic. I can't remember.
Yeah.
I can't remember right now. But not very much, I have to say. No. We did a lot of work with LEDs and colors and stuff like that. But not filters that much.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about the lighting for mm-hmm. The Watchmen and your episodes in particular. Did you have a particular lighting, you know, philosophy for the show?
You know, it had to have some sort of like atmosphere, like some kind of like moodiness and some kind of like playing in the darker side and making it, you know, interesting. Yeah. Even, for example, the funeral scene on episode 3, you know, even though it was shot in the middle of the day, we color timed it way down, darker and bluish, kind of like if it was like a, you know, like a weird evening or something. It wasn't really a real look for a day scene. So even those scenes were treated down and creating some sort of moodiness to it, you know?
Yep. Now, when you're approaching like the Vietnam episode, episode 7, are you kind of just throwing those things out the window? Are you trying to maintain some sort of consistency, or does it not matter at all?
I think in that specific moment, it was a complete different thing. But the show asked for it. You know, the script asked for it.
Yeah.
So, you know, the same way that on episode 6, they decided to go like shoot it all in one, but it looks like a single shot in black and white. But because of what they were telling these memories that were stored in that pill that she took, all those pills. So, you know, it gave them the license to just create something completely new and completely different. And, you know, it was shot black and white with that idea in mind. With the idea that maybe the producers would not like it and then turn it back into color or something, but fortunately stayed the way it should have been, because it's amazing. I mean, to me, that episode is a masterpiece, honestly.
Yeah. I want to talk about lighting and filming main characters with masks on.
Uh-huh.
So much of a performance is in the facial expression, certainly the eyes, and yes, eyes are visible for most of these people, but when you know that, you know, a good portion of your talent is going to be in masks at certain times, how do you approach that?
Well, like Angela Barr, for example, she had this like non-outfit with a huge cape over her head, her face, and with like her eyes painted black. So it was like she was in a cocoon. Like it was like, how do I get light into her face? You know, so it was a tricky thing to figure out like how to light that. I mean, it was tricky. Yeah. Mostly her character because of the way it was. The other challenging one.
Well, how did you do it? How did you overcome that challenge?
I don't know. I mean, I guess like using bounce light to get light in there, light from underneath, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, mostly like that. I mean, at the end, it's like, it's when you think you're going to have issues, for example, when you're, if you have like a Caucasian and an African-American skins in the same frame, you think it's going to be difficult, but there's a way to like light, for example, like darker skin. I find that if you bounce light as opposed to shooting light direct, it kind of like makes them glow. So it kind of like reflects the light on their skin. And so that's a way to like bring it up, you know? So I think I did a lot of that, like bouncing light, you know?
Yeah. To get like kind of under that hood or whatever it was. Yeah. To get light in there.
Right.
And then what about masks? I mean, you're working with people wearing masks. You have to film them. You still have to get performances. You still have to get some sort of emotion from them within those masks. Talk to me a little bit about the challenges of doing that and how you approach lighting for it.
I think just the same way. I mean, because the masks, you know, except for like the panda head, you know, which you don't really see the actor's face, but all the others are very like simple, you know, like covering. So it's not that you can't see their eyes or their expressions. It's very simple.
I want to talk about the way that you shot and lit Looking Glass, because he had that reflective mask on.
Yeah.
And I'd love to know just how that whole thing was done. How did you shoot it? How did you light it? And how did they, you know, achieve that effect in the reflective mask?
Anything that when Looking Glass was wearing the mask, if it was a long shot and he was way back there, it was a physical silver mask that he was wearing, you know, because it looked just the same. But if he got into, you know, intimate with him, like close to him, or he was talking to somebody else, then he was wearing a black mask with kind of like geometrical figures. I guess that's just to help map the shape of the face. For later reproduction of the actual silver reflective surface, no? And then on top of that, he was wearing a camera in the front and a camera in the back, like a 360 view, 180 on either side, or I think those cameras view even more than that, like super wide angle lenses, one in the front, one in the back. And so whatever he was performing, anything that he was pointing at, all that information with that camera, then our VFX department would pull that information and use it to reflect it on the final mask when it was created, which was like a mirror, you know. They spent a lot of money on that, just on that episode for that effect.
Oh my God. It just having to get rid of all the camera and lights, to just that in and of itself must have been an incredible challenge.
Yeah, because everything was reflected there, like lights, cameras, crew, everything besides, but they just pulled out the things that they wanted to reflect. I mean, it's not a perfect mirror when you see the face. No, it has like reflections, but you can feel the other person, even if it's talking or not, or you can feel everything. But you're, of course, they can paint out anything they don't want to reflect on. You know?
Sure. Now, did you have to make any modifications to the lighting or cinematography to allow for, you know, the visual effects departments to do what they needed to do?
No, I lit it the same way. They always come up with their balls, the silver and the solid spheres, so they can see how the light reacts in volume, and also to see what the reflections are. So they use that information. And because his face was not really going to be used because there was a mask there, so it didn't matter. Now, when he pulled the mask up, like up to his forehead, then they would create the rest of it, and then I could see the face. So then I would just like the face as I would do in any situation.
Yeah. Did you have a lot of visual effects work in the rest of your episodes? Like, is that something you enjoy working with?
I do. I mean, the episode 5 was a very challenging one because we had that beginning of the episode, which is the, you know, looking glass as a kid, when he is the same day where the, when in the comic book, the giant squid is dropped on Manhattan, killing 3 million people. And so I love that beginning because that's an immediate reference to the comic book. Like,
yeah.
So that was super fun to do and to create. I mean, it took us, you know, weeks and weeks with the production designer and myself to figure out the layout for the fun house with the mirrors and how we were going to shoot it, how we're going to avoid camera reflections, you know. So it took, you know, making little models and playing with shapes. And we even brought in, you know, we finally ended up shooting through, you know, see-through mirrors. Mm. So we placed a couple of them like portals on our set so that we could put the camera through and shoot through it. Of course, it had a weird thing because shooting through that glass is like almost like if you put like a chocolate filter on the camera. It's really, really brown. So yeah, all of yeah. that had to be factored out when we did the final coloring. But so just planning that was a challenge. And then, of course, that the end of that scene, which is when the camera pulls away from our character's face and then that blends into this animation, this CG world of Manhattan where the camera pulls all the way back to reveal the squid. You know, that was a lot of work together with VFX, special effects, camera rigs, and myself and everybody to accomplish it. Like, what was the direction of the camera? What piece of equipment I had to use to do that? You know, we used like a cable cam. We had to like turn the set, you know, in the beginning, the production design had already the layout of the fair on the street that we were allowed to in Newnan, I think was the town. And so when I got there to see, there were so many cables, you know, electricity cables. And I said, you know, it's going to be impossible to do this with a cable cam. We need to have clearance to put that cable up. And I said, is it possible if we swing the set around 180, put the fun house instead of on that end of the street, put it on the opposite? And it kind of like threw everybody off, like, well, we already decided this way. And it's like, yeah, but you need to help me out with this. So they finally turned the set around 180. And I think it worked okay. You know, the way we shot it, it doesn't really matter. And yeah. that gave us the possibility to install this huge rig to have the camera fly over everybody dead on the ground. And then that movement, then giving the VFX team like enough of that shot so that they could blend it into their animation, you know? And it was super fun. I mean, that show is fantastic.
That's got to be so much fun working with so many visual effects like that yeah. and really making a scene and collaborating with a whole team that you yeah. just wouldn't be able to have that shot otherwise.
Yeah.
We got a question here from Twitter from Jaden Marvel asking about blocking. Now, he's specifically asking about episode 6, which you didn't work on, so you can't really talk to that. But I think the question here is just in general about blocking for maybe challenging scenes like this. Like, what is your approach to blocking some of the scenes that you've worked on? And maybe you can just isolate one scene to reference. But I think just what's your approach to blocking?
As I said before, it's like a lot of it is the planning on how you're going to tell the story. But let's say, for example, let's go back to that scene at the fair. You have all the elements and you have the location. And for example, there was a church on the background. And so we're trying to figure out what is the best direction to bring these kids into the fair, introduce them to this reality of sinners, you know, like it's described in that episode. And then how do we go into the fun house? So what is the best way to approach all of that? So we can like map out on location what the route could be. And then, you know, when you find things that can, you know, you read the script and you know that this guy is also like has this kind of like AA group for people who were in the blast in 1985 or whenever that happened. No? You remember he goes to that church and he has this group. So I remember there was that church on the story, no? And so when we got to locations at the fair, I saw that there was a church right there. And it's like, oh, perfect. Why don't we start on the church as the school bus comes into frame, and then we pull back and reveal these kids coming down into the fair to like talk to the sinners, you know? So kind of like all the elements start to to get into place. So I thought it was an interesting idea to start, even if nobody really catches it. I think it's like, why do we start with the church? Well, it's something has to do with that little piece of information later on, you know?
Yeah.
So I kind of like visually and you know, when you see the script and you see that it's like an introduction into this world. So then you, with the production designer, with the director, we try to plan the blocking in a way that goes along with what is scripted, no? Like if it says like, you know, the kids start to see all these people and the description of these people, what they're doing, and they call sinners, you know? So then we know how to proceed in the space, you know, to find our characters. So that's, all those elements are put together to accomplish a blocking scene. I mean, if it's something simple, I mean, even two characters in an apartment has its, yeah, its tricks. For example, when the senator comes to Laurie Blake's house in the beginning of episode 3, you know, the way she opens the door, the way he comes in, the way he goes back to the owl in the background, and she's serving a glass of water in the foreground. Like every little piece was planned, you know? How we're gonna, you know, she carries the, or when she comes into the apartment with a mouse, carrying the mouse to feed the owl that you don't see yet. You know, every shot was planned. Every movement was designed, you know, in advance. But, you know, once you see the location or the set, in that case, that was the set, then you start playing with your space. I mean, cinematography is like architecture in a way. It's like finding the spaces and finding the angles and finding the perspectives and finding the how the light interacts in a space. So it's funny, but there's a lot of relationship between the way you approach a scene in a location or in a set and the way you admire architecture, you know?
It sounds like you had a lot of creative freedom on the show.
We did. But again, it was scripted. It was, you know, we were like pushed, let's say, to get creative, because that's what the show was asking for. And that's what Damon was asking for. And that was what the show was asking for. So that was the fun part of that show.
Well, the show is absolutely fantastic. It's called The Watchmen. It's on HBO. All episodes are available now if you guys are HBO subscribers. I want to end our episode with a little bit of a discussion about just your past. You know, you're from Mexico, eventually transitioned to the US for work. Tell me about that. I mean, were you working as a cinematographer in Mexico, or did you come right to the US to begin your career?
No, I started, I went to film school in Mexico City and I started my career there. I did a lot of, back in those days, I did a lot of, not a lot of, but some camera assisting. And I actually ended up being the focus puller on Total Recall.
I saw that. It's funny, when I went to your IMDb and it says like known for, and I saw Total Recall there, I'm like, did he shoot Total Recall? How is that
possible? I wish.
My God, what a great experience that must have been.
Yeah, that was like a super highlight, you know. You know, I started first as a second assistant, and like a month into the movie, Annette, who was Yost's partner and the operator, I mean, the first assistant, she moved up to operating and they invited me to become the focus puller. So, and Yost Bacano said like, we're going to give you a chance. If you can do it, you stay. And if you screw up and we're in then we'll go back to the other configuration, but never happened. So I just stayed there, you know?
Yeah.
I think I was a good focus puller, I think.
is that the way up, do you think? I mean, is that the way in for new, you know, new young kids out there that want to get into this industry? Should they be coming in as a camera assistant? What do you think is the best path? And I know it's different for everybody, but what do you think?
Well, I think you answered it. I mean, it is definitely different for everyone. I think you find your own path and you create your own path. I mean, there's people who never assisted and they're amazing cinematographers. There's people who came in through being gaffers. Some people who came up the ladder from, you know, loader, operator, you know, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. My suggestion is just take all the opportunities that you can, that present, you know, to yourself. Like, if you want, if if they offer you to do something, do it. Don't doubt it. And if you don't know it, learn it, or just say yes. You know, I remember my dad saying, when he was an architect, and you know, when he first started his career, he got some project, and you know, he didn't even know how to do it. He just said yes. And then after he said yes, he got the job. Then he started, you know, looking for people who knew how to do it, you know?
Oh my God. Is that not the best way? It really is. I mean, you got to just say yes and figure it out.
Yes. Yeah. Because no matter what, I mean, if you look at it, if you think about it, it's pretty much the same as like doing Watchmen. Like, okay, here's the script. The camera flies. I don't know how to do that. Well, let's find out. You know, so it's kind of like the same process. You have to like find a way to do it. And you can always call and ask, you know, research or read, or, you know, there's all these resources out there that you can just, you know, figure it out somehow, you know.
For me, I think the telltale sign that someone is at the beginning of their career, or not, or that they don't even necessarily really have a great handle over what their career is when they think they know how to do everything. Like when I'm working with someone and they tell me, I don't know how to do that, but I want to learn and I know exactly the right person to call to figure out how to do it. Right. Then I know I'm working with someone that has been through challenges before. They've seen things before. They've overcome stuff. Like, I think that is the best thing for young cinematographers is just don't pretend you know everything. Like, admit that you don't, but show the person that you're talking to that you're that you have the will to figure it out.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I mean, we all go through situations. I mean, the first scene on episode 5 was this research group. How do you say research group? No.
Research group, yeah.
Yeah. So this scene where, you know, they're interviewing these people about New York and, you know, kind of like making a questionnaire on a research group. And I remember we did the research. That was, I don't know, for whatever reason, we did the blocking, the rehearsal. And then it's like, how do we start? And I was like, I don't know. I have no idea where to start. And then it's like, okay, well, I don't know. Let's put the camera here and put the other one there. And so, you know, sometimes it's very clear what you're going to do. Sometimes you don't have it clear. And so you start building it as you go, you know. But I guess not being afraid of sometimes saying, I don't know, because, you know, you're not God to know everything. So sometimes you don't know it. And it's like, okay, let's just figure it out, you know. Some people get nervous. When I said that moment, like, I don't know, it was like, oh my God, what's going to happen? What's going to happen? You know, it was like, don't worry, we'll figure it out. I'm just being honest. I don't know.
Exactly. I love that. I love that. Any advice for, you know, new filmmakers out there listening that, you know, look at your work and really are aspiring to do that level of cinematography?
Keep on watching movies. Keep on watching art. Pay attention to every situation that you walk into. Look at the light that comes through your window. Look what happens when you turn on this light or the other. Go to museums, a lot of museums, you know. Look at art, look at pictures. You know, just be inspired with anything, like the way a tree moves with the wind. I mean, anything is an inspiration because, you know, it's light, it's motion, it's poetry. So just be open to all this, all your senses, and try to take it all in. I say that because I could have said also, like, you know, take all the opportunities and do your best and learn this and learn that. But that's,
well, that's a given.
Anyway. Yeah. So
that's a given.
Why not just go and explore your life?
Well, you mentioned architecture a few times in this interview, and then you just revealed a couple minutes ago your father was an architect.
Right.
So that, I mean, I love an architect's approach to space. Like, I think coming at cinematography, thinking about locations with some architecture experience, not even experience, but just appreciation, is crucial. And I love that you mentioned it a bunch of times, and it had to have been because it was in your, no, it was in your home.
It was in my home, yeah. I actually went to architecture school for like a semester, and then And then I said, no, this is not for me, you know. And then I quit and I went to film school.
Well, what did you pick up from that semester? There must have been something that you took with you.
I think more from that semester, I would say more from just working with my dad and seeing what he did and going to his, you know, his construction sites and stuff. So,
yeah.
But yeah, I mean, it's just like learning about the way you appreciate architecture, the way you're saying it, like the way you understand, you know, see, I love going out to see places and going to spaces and see what they feel like and see how they are lit naturally, you know, and yeah. So that's where you learn from. And I have the sense of what a space is. I mean, how do you move in a space, or how do you understand this space that you're working on? What are the right angles? How does it have an impact depending where you put your eye, you know?
Yeah, I love that.
So yeah, it's working with volume and light and depth and, you know, so all these elements that we're using on cinematography the same way.
All right, well, thank you so much for being on Go Creative Show. Of course, guys, you know the show, The Watchmen. It's on HBO. And if you're not a subscriber to HBO, what's wrong with you? There's so much amazing content on there. Come on now. So you have to go on there. You got to watch The Watchmen and all of the things on there as well. Javier, thank you so much for being on. Where can people go to find out more about you? Are you on Instagram or Twitter? Where are you?
If you go XMexDP, that's my website and my Instagram.
XMex, X-M-E-X. DP on Instagram. So you can check out his work there. And of course, we'll put that in the show notes as well. So Javier, thank you so much for being
on.
Thank
you. Thank you so much.
All right. I want to thank Javier Grobet for coming on Go Creative Show and talking to us all about Watchmen. I know I learned a lot. And if I'm learning something, you're learning something. We're all learning something. And that's the whole point of Go Creative Show. I also want to thank our sponsors, Post Lab, stress-free collaboration in Final Cut Pro and Premiere, and MZ, Education for Creatives. Without these people, the show wouldn't exist, so please support those that support us. I also want to thank the behind-the-scenes team making it all happen, our producer, Connor Crosby. You can find him at ignitionvisuals.com, and Matt Russell, who mixes and masters and makes the show sound so good. You can find him at gainstructure.com and on Twitter at gainstructure. And while you're on Twitter, follow us. In fact, follow us everywhere, Instagram, YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, all over the place, and subscribe to us on your favorite podcast app so you never miss an episode. And on that note, we're going to see you next week on another episode of Go Creative Show, a podcast for filmmakers.